How did you reach here? That's the sermon title. How did you reach here? So this will be a two-part series. So today we are going to look at a young man named King Saul. Do you know that no one ever had a better or a sadder finish than this young man Saul? Do you agree with me? He had a beautiful beginning. At the same time, he had a terrible end. And he had all the credentials to be successful. So today we are going to look at two things. One, number one is resume of Saul. Number two is performance appraisal. Are you ready? Resume of Saul and performance appraisal of Saul. So let's turn to the Word of God. First Samuel chapter 9. So let me read this first two verses. I'm looking at the resume of Saul. So there was a man of Benjamin whose name was Kish, the son of Abel, the son of Zeror, the son of Bechorath, the son of Aphia, a Benjamite, a mighty man of power. And he had a choice and handsome son whose name was Saul. There was not a more handsome person than he among the children of Israel. From his shoulders upward, he was taller than any of the people. What you can find in this resume is he was a young man, right? And he has a godly dad. Isn't it wonderful today, especially godly dad? Then handsome among men. Can I claim that? May not be. How many of you can claim handsome among men? There are more handsome people on the chat itself right now, Zoom. So I cannot claim handsome among men, tallest. I cannot, because there are people taller than me sometimes, head and shoulders above other people. A good candidate, a very good candidate for Hollywood hero's role. He would get a job or a chance to work in movies anywhere. Anyone would grab him. Height-wise, handsomeness, and everything you can see, Saul had it. Nothing can avoid him from being successful, at least in the worldly point of view. So what do you think? Look at the next part of his resume. Handsome. He is handsome. But I want to bring out something. Now you can see his character-wise or his heart part. He was not an arrogant guy. Do you know that? He was not an arrogant guy. He was a humble man. Prophet Samuel, he came to Saul and he came to him and he said something. Let's turn to verse 15 of this same chapter 9. Verse 15. Now the Lord had told Samuel in his ear. Who? God came and told Samuel in his ear. The day before Saul came, saying, tomorrow, about this time, I will send you a man from the land of Benjamin, and you shall anoint him commander over my people Israel, that he may save my people from the hand of the Philistines. For I have looked upon my people, because their cry has come to me. So God told prophet Samuel. What did God say? Saul is your man. Hey, go after this man. Anoint this man and let him be the king. And this Samuel comes to Saul. Now, let's pause for a minute. Now, you are that person. Let's say Pastor Joshin or Pastor Alexander or Moses. Let me take the name of Moses. Young man, right? So, Moses or Joshua, the youngest guy. Okay? Now, Joshua, he gets a chance like this. And Prophet Samuel, instead of Thomas Matthew, comes and tells you, hey, Joshua, hey, Samuel, I have a great news. Do you know yesterday God spoke to me? Do you know what God told me? You are the king of Israel. I want to anoint you. Look at the response of Saul. Now, how would you react? You would say, wow. You would say, is it that? No. You'd confidently look at this prophet. Pastor Thomas, I knew one day I would be a king. Do you know why? I was the tallest man. Come on. I was handsome. I was good looking. Come on. I know there is nobody who can be a king. I'm the eligible candidate. But instead of saying that, I know, I knew in my spirit that I would be one day king. Instead of that, King Saul is telling something in verse 21. Look at Saul's response. Am I not a Benjamite, of the smallest of the tribes of Israel, and my family the least of all the families of the tribe of Benjamin? Why then do you speak like this to me? Why then do you speak like this to me? I am not eligible. I am not eligible. You might say I'm handsome. You might say I'm good looking. You might say I'm the tallest, but I'm not eligible. Humble, so much he was. He did not say I deserve this, but he was feeling that he was unworthy for that job. I'm talking about the resume of King Saul. Let's continue to look at his resume. Chapter 10, verse 1. Then Samuel took a flask of oil and poured it on his head and kissed him and said, is it not because the Lord has anointed you commander over his inheritance? Then now look at verse 6. Then the Spirit of the Lord will come upon you, and you will prophesy with them and be turned into another man. And let it be, when these signs come to you, that you do as the occasion demands, for God is with you. What an amazing thing. You know, he's tall. He's tallest. He's the most handsome guy. Now he has one more qualification in his resume. I'm anointed. So tall, handsome, chosen by God, and a man anointed of God with a holy anointing. And because of that, the Holy Spirit came upon Saul with great power. Wow. Come on. This is amazing. How many of you can boast like this? You have every credential to be successful. And how would you like to be around such a person like King Saul? Handsome, tall, strong, good heritage, chosen of God, and humble, anointed of the Spirit of God. What a wonderful resume he has. Now let us continue to look at his resume. His attitude. Do you know his attitude was very good? His attitude was, look at again the same chapter. His resume reads in verse 26. Saul also went home to Gibeah, and valiant men went with him whose hearts God had touched. But some rebels said, how can this man save us? That's the question. How can this man save us? Critics. So they despised him and brought him no presents. Is that all? Anything you can see after that? But he held his peace. Look at his attitude. There were some people who didn't like Saul. Saul did not talk back to those people. They despised him. But Saul did not react. His attitude was good. I'm talking about a beautiful resume. Credentials that are so highly evaluated. And further, you can see his attitude in the chapter 11. Let's look at chapter 11. I'm running through the resume of Saul. Verse 12. Then the people said to Samuel, Who is he? Who said, shall Saul reign over us? That's a question. Shall Saul reign over us? Who are these people? He's talking about these same men who despised him and brought him no presents. Okay? Now look at the next part. Bring the men that we may put them to death. So there is one side we can put them to death. But look at verse 13. His attitude. But Saul said, not a man shall be put to death this day. For today the Lord has accomplished salvation in Israel. Hey, come on. Do you see that? One word from Saul. One command from Saul, and these people would have been put to death. But Saul here, on the other hand, he's loving. He's loving his enemies. He's doing good to those who hate him. He is blessing those who despise him. He had the power to put these people, kill these people, but he didn't do that. Hallelujah. He didn't do that. So here was a man who was given an assignment to be the king, a shepherd over the most wonderful nation, Israel. Hallelujah. He is the king of Israel. And most importantly, the first king of Israel. Amen. First king of Israel. What an opportunity it is to be Israel's king. Do you know something? As I read this passage, I feel like telling you, some people have great opportunity, but many people don't have the ability. And some people have great ability, but they don't have the opportunity. But here in the case of Saul, it's different. He had both opportunity and he had both ability. It doesn't come quite often. It doesn't work that way. But he is such a privileged and a blessed person that he had everything, credential-wise, blessing-wise, opportunity-wise. He came at such a time. In the 1 Samuel chapter 8, there was a dialogue between Samuel, God, and the people of Israel. And Samuel said, "My friends, my people, I want to tell you, God doesn't want you to have a king. If you have a king, it is not going to be good." And he kept on telling through the Spirit of the Lord what will happen to the people of Israel instead of depending on the God as a king, instead of depending on a human king. After all the prophecy, people said, "We still want a king. We still want a king." He was a man in a million. He had the opportunity and he had a beautiful start. But at the same time, I want to bring out, he also had a terrible end. How did he reach there? What's the title? How did you reach here? How did you reach here, Saul? How could you become what you became? Why are you straying away from the original calling of yours? And that is what God would like to remind many of the anointed people, especially the young people who are on this Cornerstone Zoom line. You are young, you're energetic, you have got wonderful gifts, wonderful, wonderful talents, and wonderful opportunities God giving you today. The question arises, how would you maintain? Someone told like this, buying a car would be expensive for you, but remember, maintaining a car is equally difficult. Saul bought a car, but did he maintain it well? You had the gift of the anointing of the Holy Spirit. You had the privilege of being called as the children of the Most High God. How important it is for us to understand and remember today in the morning session that we need to commit ourselves every day to the Holy Spirit and say, "God, I want you to maintain this body. I want you to maintain this life that you've given to us. Help me." So we looked at the resume of Saul. Now let's look at the performance appraisal. Maybe I was working in companies, that's why I'm using these terminologies. But I'm sure many of you know that. Performance appraisal of Saul. Are you ready for that? Saul did not drift away from his tasks and responsibilities immediately. Do you know that? Hey, do you know that? Many times we don't understand. How did you reach here? You started a journey. The journey was good. But what about your journey? How do you travel? With whom do you travel? How well you are communicated with the one who you are traveling with is very, very important. And let's look at the performance appraisal. The detachment of Saul from God was very, very slow. And that is very important for us to remember this. You will not become a backslidden person overnight. Let me turn to 1 Samuel chapter 13. verse 5 onwards to 14 verse 14.
Then the Philistines gather together to fight with Israel 30,000 chariots and 6,000 horsemen, and people as the sand which is on the seashore in multitude. And they came up and encamped in Michmash, to the east of Beth Avon. When the men of Israel saw that they were in danger, for the people were distressed, then the people hid in caves, in thickets, in rocks, in holes, and in pits. And some of the Hebrews crossed over the Jordan to the land of Gad and Gilead. As for Saul, he was still in Gilgal, and all the people followed him trembling. Then he waited 7 days, according to the time set by Samuel. But Samuel did not come to Gilgal, and the people were scattered from him. So Saul said,
"Bring a burnt offering and peace offerings here to me."
And he offered the burnt offering. Now it happened, as soon as he had finished presenting the burnt offering, that Samuel came. And Saul went out to meet him, that he might greet him. And Samuel said,
"What have you done?"
"When I saw that the people were scattered from me, and that you did not come within the days appointed, and that the Philistines gathered together at Michmash, then I said, 'The Philistines will now come down on me at Gilgal.' And I have not made supplication to the Lord. Therefore I felt compelled and offered a burnt offering."
"You have done foolishly. You have not kept the commandment of the Lord your God, which he commanded you. For now, the Lord would have established your kingdom over Israel forever. But now, your kingdom shall not continue. The Lord has sought for himself a man after his own heart, and the Lord has commanded him to be commander over his people, because you have not kept what the Lord commanded you."
This is an interesting incident in the life of Saul. The resume of Saul did look very good. But what about his performance appraisal? How was it? Someone had to say that you did a foolish thing. What is the foolish thing he did? You know that? If anyone wants to remember this term, you know, there is a mistake that Saul made. Saul began to operate in the flesh. Saul began operating in the flesh. How could you say that? He began to do holy things. He began to do holy things with his own ability, by his own wisdom, his own imagination. This is an interesting part in the life of every Christian. And I'm speaking to every one of you right now. God has chosen you and me. We are born again. We are dedicated to God. And I am very certain about everyone who is in front of me right now, including me. We are dedicated. We will not do any bad things in the flesh. Are you getting? We will not do any bad things in the flesh. And I believe that. Everyone, how many participants are there? Every one of you, I can say that. But we can begin by doing something very similar. What is that? Let's say, for example, if you were a drug addict and you became a believer, or if you were a gambler and you became a believer, if you were a drunkard and you became a believer, or if you were such and such person and you became a believer, you will say, "No longer I'm a slave to fear. I am a child of God." Wonderful. "I am a child of God." Oh, wonderful. Wonderful. You made a commitment. You said no to sin. You will not do that. But the enemy is waiting to get you back. Hallelujah. How do you think enemy gets you back? You know that? Two weeks back, I came to know someone went in the morning and caught some fish. They got some fish. And tell me, did that person go to the fish and say, I'm going to catch you right now. I'm going to catch you right now. That's a bait. Something that will attract the fish. And that is what the enemy will try to do. He'll bring a small bait. You'll say, ooh, you'll go and catch that. And then you don't know, you are in the net. And you'll start, I want to get out. You cannot. What I wanted to tell you is, you will not do the drug addiction, go back to drug addiction. You will not go back to the alcoholism. You will not go back to those things, but enemy knows how to get you. What did this fellow do? What did Saul do? You know that? He did something beautiful. I'll not come to that point now. Before I tell you, the biggest drawback and biggest flaw in many Christians, where they start failing is, they start doing good in the flesh. They start doing good in the flesh. Holy things outside the purview of God's will. Hey, are you getting something? Did King Saul do anything wrong? No, he didn't do. He was saying, Samuel did not come. I'm doing it. Samuel is not doing. The King Uzziah, did he do unholy thing? No. He burned the incense. He went into the altar. What was wrong in that? Why do you think King Uzziah has to get leprosy? In 1 Chronicles chapter 26, you can read later on. Doing holy things outside the will of God was the biggest drawback in the life of King Saul. And the same way I want to tell you, you can do many things in the flesh. You can sing in the flesh. You can do administration in the flesh. You can preach in the flesh. Hey, are you getting? I can preach in the flesh. I can have no experience with the Holy Spirit, yet I can preach a thunderous message and shake the audience. I can sing a wonderful song, and yet I may not be filled with the Holy Spirit if I have a good voice. If I have a voice of Yeshudas or somebody like great singers, I could sing probably beautifully. I don't need the Holy Spirit to sing a good song. I'm not talking about the flesh. I'm talking about your old nature. Hey, listen, are you getting something? Your old nature is doing fleshly things. That fleshly nature, instead of depending upon God, will depend upon yourself. Flesh can sing a good song. Flesh can teach a good lesson. Flesh can lead a strong program. Flesh can do a good pastor's job also. Flesh can have a big choir program. By the way, the best choir master is not you and me, my friend. None of you can beat the choir master who fell down. His name is Lucifer. He was a beautiful singer. So remember one thing. You can have a big choir program. You can have a big church. Flesh can do all that. Yeah, do you think I'm trying to teach you something wrong? I was talking to someone on the Zoom a few days ago who is there right now. I was talking to that person. I was telling, seven churches. One was a church that was very popular. Church at Sardis. And Bible says that you're dead. Church at Ephesus lost their first love. One after the other. I'm not going to take those seven churches story, but you only found one church, Philadelphia Church. That was faithful church. One was lukewarm. One had the teachings of Balaam. One had the spirit of Jezebel. What am I trying to say? They were all churches. They were all doing something, doing good in the flesh. Hey, doing good in the flesh. Saul was doing that. Everyone can say to Saul, wow, Saul, you're gifted. And you're not doing bad in the flesh. You're doing good in the flesh. You're doing holy things in the flesh. That is what Saul was doing. He was out of the will of God. Otherwise, why do you think Samuel had to say to Saul, saying that, you foolish fellow? Once the devil got that area of getting you doing the good things in the flesh, let me add something. It won't be very long that he can make you do bad things in the flesh. You want me to go there? I'll take you for a few minutes. Doing good things in the flesh led him to do bad things in the flesh. Devil is very clever. He knows how to use an anointed person and how to trick on this guy, this gifted people. And he induced and he seduced these people to act foolishly initially. So first of all, here the point is, Saul was self-determined. Have you heard, I'm a self-made man? Many people saying, I'm a self-made man. The moment you start hearing, you will say he has started doing the fleshly jobs, doing good in the flesh. Now, step number two, how did he reach there? How did a person reach there? Is the self-determination to a point of stubborn disobedience. Are you getting stubborn disobedience? I'm going to close the last point. This is the last point. Chapter 15. Come on. Chapter 15, verse 1 to 3. Here you can see Samuel said to Saul, the Lord sent me to anoint you king over his people, over Israel. Now therefore, heed the voice of the words of the Lord. Thus says the Lord of hosts, I will punish Amalek for what he did to Israel, how he ambushed him on the way when he came up from Egypt. Now go and attack Amalek and utterly destroy all that they have, and do not spare them, but kill both man and woman, infant and nursing child, ox and sheep, camel and donkey. Everyone, finish them. Instruction is very clear. Utterly destroy the Amalekites. These people need to be eradicated. You might think that God is very cruel, very harsh. But I went through something and I came to know why God had to say that God wanted these Amalekites to be destroyed. Because the history says they were terrible people. And they did whatever they want, and whatever they did, wherever they went, was not anywhere holy. And they could not do any good thing. They oppressed the weaker people. They raped the women. They cut the pieces of living flesh and, you know, hang it in the air to taunt the people of Israel. They were demon worshippers. So God was actually doing a favor, because God wanted to make sure that by removing them, he is making the world more a livable place, a place where everyone can live in harmony. So here comes the instruction very clear. Saul goes, and what he did was very interesting. He spares King Agag, who was the king of Amalekites. And he takes the best of the sheep and the best of the oxen that God set to destroy. And he saves them all alive. Did God say that to him? No. Partial disobedience. When Samuel asked him one question, did you do what the Lord told you to do? What was his answer? No, I didn't do. He didn't say that. Look at his response. In verse 20, but I have obeyed the voice of the Lord and gone on the mission on which the Lord sent me. Wonderful. Praise God. You did. And brought back Agag, king of Amalek. I have utterly destroyed the Amalekites. But the people took off the plunder, sheep and oxen, the best of the things which should have been utterly destroyed, to sacrifice to the Lord, your God in Gilgal. So his purpose was good, huh? He wanted to take these things sacrifice. Matthew chapter 5, verse 22 and 23. 23 says, when you feel someone is angry with you, you go and reconcile with that person. And one thing that was stunning to me as I was meditating that passage is, the Holy Spirit was telling and Jesus was telling, leave that at the altar. And he doesn't say anything. He says, go and reconcile. Leave that at the altar. That means what you're offering, what you're coming with is tainted, is stained. Hallelujah. Stained glass. It's broken pieces. You cannot come to God with broken pieces. You're coming to a holy God. The Cain and Abel story is again the same thing. The holy God, we are coming with a, you know, anger. We are coming with a different attitude to God. God said, go and reconcile that. Cain, if you do what is good, will I not be happy? Go and do whatever you can. Reconcile. Sin is crouching at your door in Genesis chapter 4. So coming back to here, we come to a point, initially we did good in the flesh. Now we do bad in the flesh. We come to a point, we don't understand where you're going wrong. We don't understand what's going wrong. We are blinded. We are not having an awareness of where we are. It all began well. He doesn't even realize where he went wrong. Even now he is justifying. He knows what instruction he got. He's still justifying that, God, I wanted to come and give this offering. Ah, good, very good. And what was the response of Samuel is, it's a great, two verses are great in the Bible. Look at the same chapter 15, verse 22. So Samuel said, has the Lord as great delight in burnt offering and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Question mark. Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to heed than the fat of rams. On the other hand, you see the warning, which is again the greatest warning in the Bible. The next verse, 23. For rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft. Are you getting that? The moment you start rebelling, you're inviting witchcraft spirit. We don't have to go to a witchcraft to understand whether we have the spirit of witchcraft. We are already having the spirit if we are disobeying God. For rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft, and stubbornness is as iniquity and idolatry. Because you have rejected the word of the Lord, he also has rejected you as being king. So here is Saul. We looked at the resume. Wonderful resume. Believe me, he gets a job anywhere. But what about his performance appraisal? Number one, he did good in the flesh. Then he came to a point, he never realized he was doing bad in the flesh at all. He's running ahead of God. Are you getting that? The first thing was, he was doing good in the flesh by running ahead of God. Do you want one more verse? Just open your Bible later on in Matthew chapter 7, in the Sermon on the Mount. As Jesus was closing, benediction was coming. The wise man built his house upon a rock. Wise man built his house on a rock. All this, you know, we know that. In that, before that, he says, many will come and say, did I not prophesy? Did I not heal? Did I not do this? All good in the flesh. Why? Prophesy is not bad. Prophecy is not bad. Prophesying is not bad. Healing is not bad. Blessing a person is not bad. But what was the problem? I do not know you at all. I do not know you at all. Why? Because you were doing good in the flesh, not running with me. Many times we run ahead of God. Someone mentioned like this, when you drive at 160 kilometers speed, you forget one fact that angels are 40 kilometers behind you if the road is 120 kilometers. If you're road is instructing you 100 kilometers. Angels will come with you when you're driving at 100 kilometers. Amen. I am not talking about the speed of the car. I'm talking about obeying the will of God, obeying the plan of God. The moment you disobey, you are in the dominion of things that can take over you and me. We might think we're doing a good job. You're doing a good job. So I wanted to round up here. How is our resume looking today? Wonderful. I have a beautiful resume. Let me tell you, I have a beautiful resume. I can say I came to the Lord 1989. Then what? Oh, I did so much. I conducted so many small groups. Wonderful. Oh, I preach on prayer line from November 2012. Wonderful resume, Pastor Thomas. Oh, now I have young people in my church, Cornerstone Church. Oh, very good, good resume. But my question to myself to start with is, am I doing in the flesh or am I doing it in the spirit? Hallelujah. Am I doing good in the flesh? It might sound and seem to be good, but am I seeking God's direction in every single step that I take? I'm including myself, the oldest guy among you. How are we going about in our day-to-day life? Are we asking God, God, you walked with me once. I know that day when heavens came down and glory filled my soul, when at the cross my Savior filled my life. Glory came upon my life. I could see the light of God. I could experience the resurrected power of Jesus. I've seen the miracles and healings in the lives of people, deliverances in the lives of people once upon a time. But how about that today? Do I carry my resume, which is old, stale, dated? How is my performance appraisal today? Performance appraisal is not from human beings. If Jesus has to come to me, will he pat on my back and say, well done, my servant? Or am I waiting for the pat on the back from some of the people who are around me and not from the Holy Spirit and from God? Then I think I'm losing my direction and I think you are losing your direction. So I want you to take some time, maybe a minute, pause, speak to God, mute yourself, don't worry, just talk to God and tell him, God, how about my resume and how about my performance appraisal? How about my performance appraisal? How do you appraise me today? Can you please send me an email today? Let me read through what you feel about me. I want to read, oh God. I want to read. I want to read. And I'm sure that our resume is given by God. And it's God who will retain our credentials if we abide in him. Father, we thank you for talking to every one of us today. Father, we commit every one of us, O Lord. We pray that we will not just preach the word. Preaching the word can be done by anyone. We don't need Holy Spirit. But God, we pray that may our words, may our action synchronize, Lord, that you will appraise us well, that we are not running ahead of you. We are walking with the Holy Spirit. We are listening to the voice of the Holy Spirit. We are obeying every word that you speak to us. Bless us, O God. Bless everyone who joined this Zoom meeting today. Thank you and praise you, Master, for answering our prayers. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.